Hello, malty, moody, majestic, magnificent malt mates, and thank you to Graham Fraser for that malt mention for introducing, yeah, it's an extras, and it's 834 extras. Welcome, malt mates. Welcome to the Bothy. Welcome to an extras in which I'm going to discuss not just the fact that we add water to whiskey, but how we add water to whiskey. Let's start with the quality of the water we're using. You can use bottled water, but if you can filter tap water, it's absolutely fine. I know there's been a fashion for using water and whiskey that's been sourced at the distillery, but frankly, that really isn't necessary. It's just one of these added frilly extras that the absolute diehard malt mates just simply love because it gives them something extra to talk about that other people can't. So I've got a glass of water here. You'll notice it's a pint glass. It's been sitting for a day with a lid on it. This helps to clear all the chlorine that's been put in to sterilise the water. It helps to lift that out. And also the fact that it's been through a filter jug as well. That certainly helps. I use a Brita filter jug, which I just fill from the tap. I'm lucky in the island, man. The water we have here, although it's heavily chlorinated, they don't do much else to it because we're totally off the map. And it really is not that important. And frankly, it makes a lot of sense. So, no fluoride. That's a scandal that's going to break elsewhere fairly soon. Whiskey. You can drink whiskey neat, but bear in mind, particularly when it's cask strength whiskey or higher strength whiskey, the physical nip and the behaviour of ethanol on your tongue will actually act as an aesthetic, and there's no point in saying it's all right, my saliva will dilute the whiskey. That's true, but it's very nominal, it's very slight, and it's not enough. To get access to the full range of flavours in your whiskey, particularly when it is at cask strength, and particularly when it has age, you're going to add a drop of water. The older your whiskey is, the less water you add. If you have a 25-year-old whiskey, a 30 or 40-year-old whiskey, you're going to add a drop or two of water, but no more. You're going to leave your whiskey for about 15 minutes before you even taste it. Sure, you're going to check it when you first pour, smell and taste, just to help you get your bearings. But you'll find that with first pour of a glass, the flavours jumbled, not so much the smell kind of starts to creep out the top of the glass fairly quickly, but the flavours are kind of jumbled and condensed. Whiskey's a living thing, it needs time, like we all do. Now, when you're adding water to old whiskies, do so slowly and gradually. Do not dump water into your glass all at once, because you will soon discover from practical experience when you drown your whiskey. You cannot add more whiskey to it to undrown it. It doesn't work. You've got to put that glass aside, put another whiskey in, accept a younger whiskey and accept that you've now got a very good quality blend, but you're leaving that for later, just an experiment. You've got to re-pour the glass. You've got to start from scratch. And what you do is you just add one drop. You can use a spoon or you can use a straw. You can buy fancy glass straws, but feel free just to use a disposable plastic or even a cardboard straw. They're absolutely fine. There's not a huge amount of waste, but don't, when you're getting rid of them, burn them. So there's no plastic waste going into the environment. What I do is actually, I just rinse the plastic straw and reuse it. And I know that comes across probably as incredibly mean and tight, but hey, I am a bit mean and tight. Not totally, just in certain ways. When you're dealing with a younger whiskey, you can be a little bit more generous with the water. Have a taste, first of all. See how it is, because some seriously light whiskies, it's just the way they've gone in the cask, the direction they've gone, they've lost their energy, they've lost their mojo, they've become paler in play paler profiled versions of themselves. So you can get, for example, an Auchentoshan, which is from an independent bottler, or a Little Mill, or a Tam na Vullan, for example, another good example. And these are light whiskies. Dalwhinnie's another great example of this. And what will happen is it just seems thin in the glass, and you realise, actually, I've just got to enjoy this as it is. I cannot add any water at all, because as soon as I do so, it starts to fall to bits. It starts to just become diluted like a wine, and a light wine at that. There's just some whiskies that are out there. It's to do with the provenance of the cask. It's to do with the direction that the maturation went, that the cask didn't do much. And over time, because of that lack of interaction, quite simply, the single malt whiskies lost its signature and identity. You'll know when you see it. So I've added, this is the glass from a previous review. So I've added 5 milliliters of water, because I know that at 46.3%, and by the way, this is Lecheg 18-year-old, an excellent contemporary peated sherried single malt. Just sharing. And then you notice a little bit of Scotch mist appearing in the glass. Isn't that beautiful? Isn't that wonderful? It's continuing to open up and expand long after I've completed my last review, because of course, as you're aware, I've recorded them back to back. Review 834 followed by 834 extras to make full use of keeping the Bothy clean, warm, and heated and lit. That's the way Bothies are. What I now know that from experience, and you should go in your experience, is when you've added a drop of water, give it a few minutes. Don't think for 1 minute that you add all your water at once and then it's fine. That's not the way it goes. You may find that with Glenfiddich 12-year-old, you add no water at all, or Auchentoshan American Oak, you don't add any water. And particularly with modern blends, the Johnny Walker blends, Black Label, good example. You don't want to add any water at all, because then it starts to kind of disintegrate from the blend. That's my experience, and I'm just mentioning it to you in case it's yours too. But when you're tasting it, whatever you've poured, you will come to a point where you've perfect pitched in the amount of water you've added. Now, I know from experience for this whiskey, and goodness knows I've had plenty of practice and rehearsals with it, because it's delicious. I put a full teaspoon, 5 milliliters, into standard measure. I knew that that is what would work for me. Now, tasting it 20 minutes later, I'm adding a dozen more drops of water. But after that, I'm not adding any more, because I know from the practice that I've done in my blending room and here in the Bothy, that that's as much water as the whiskey will take. It will become quite expressive in the range of flavours. It will become more mellow. It will become slightly sweeter. And you'll also notice the oak cask influence is a little more proactive and present. That's what you do. This is what you find when you add water. And just to conclude, blenders, professional blenders in blending suites in great big whiskey companies will nose a whiskey neat, but then they will add a significant amount of water to bring down the whiskey. And the reason they do it is simple, is to get access not just to the flavours, but to the component sensations, the style, the character, and the delivery of that experience, so that they can best refer to their blending recipe books, which they have, by the way. And they'll know which proportion of different whiskies are going to blend together most successfully. But importantly, when they're tasting them and spitting out, because they can't do this when they're drunk, you'd think it's a glamorous job being a blender, but it's not, far from it. In fact, after a lifetime of blending, blenders are just about sick of the stuff. They actually find it nauseous. Cutting through the romanticism is something we all must do. The sweetness, the ashiness, this glorious butterscotch syrupy moment is getting thoroughly delivered now. And I'm learning more about this whiskey because I did taste it neat when I smelled it neat. And I did taste it again after I added some water and I noticed the difference. And then I added some more water and then I noticed some more difference on the taste, on the nose. And it's seeing all the permutations of a single malt, one single malt in one glass over time through the use of water. That is how we get to know more intimately and more carefully the whiskey that we are tasting. And therefore, when we have to make big, big decisions on how we spend our money, what's a good whiskey and what isn't a good whiskey? Our best point of reference is not anybody else and their opinion and perspective and malt marks. It's our own personal experience and knowing how our palates work and what works for our palates. And then we make our buying decisions. And as time goes on, these decisions get better and better and better. Thank you, malt mates. I'm Ralfy in the Bothy. Happy to share the malt moments. I shall now get out. Here it is. Ready? I should have a countdown for this new turbo clicker. 3, 2, 1.